Remember the hypothalamus in the brain. The hypothalamus is the region of the brain that helps to control body temperature. The hypothalamus has a set point that it likes to keep the body temperature at, but the hypothalamus is made up of cells, right? And those cells can be influenced by the binding of receptors on their surfaces. So one example of a molecule that can bind to the hypothalamus and modify the temperature set point is a pyrogen. A pyrogen acts to increase the set point temperature of the body. Okay, certain pathogens, certain bacteria, if they're gram-negative bacteria, then their cell wall contains a molecule, it's a lipopolysaccharide, and this is something that stimulates monocytes and macrophages to release cytokines. One of those cytokines is a pyrogen. So if the cells of the immune system are activated in response to certain pathogens, they might actually release cytokines that go and act on the hypothalamus of the brain. And the end result of this is fever. The hypothalamus raises the set point temperature of the body, and we experience a fever as a result of that. A fever, this is something that sometimes I don't know if we do, but sometimes certain people think, oh, fever, that's bad, we need to get rid of the fever. The fever is actually doing an important job, though. As long as it doesn't get out of control, the fever can actually be very beneficial. What the fever does is it helps to decrease bacterial activity, so it slows down the pathogen, and it kind of gives the immune system a response to ramp up its activities. Perhaps the adaptive immune system needs to get involved, and this kind of buys some time to allow it to do that without the infection getting really rampant and spread throughout the body. So there's some controversy about if you get sick, should you take something to lower your fever? To some extent, that is still up for debate. Some doctors recommend let the fever do its job. Others recommend take a fever reducing medication so that you'll be more comfortable and you can rest better. As far as I know, the jury is still out on that one, but we're gonna focus in on what does the fever do. We're here to just understand physiology, not give medical advice. So let's take a look at this in a little bit more detail. Okay, so we mentioned that the monocytes and the macrophages, they are releasing these cytokines. Pyrogen is one of the cytokines that they release. They release other cytokines as well. One of the other cytokines that they release, some of the other cytokines that they release, can do things like induce sleepiness, so you will sleep more, and this is another beneficial thing when you are sick. It is good to rest. And this also helps to change iron concentration in the plasma. This is something that helps to limit bacterial activity. Some bacteria depend on that iron concentration, so if we just lower the iron concentration, that will help to slow down the bacterial infection as well. Another thing that, coming back to fever, another thing that fever does is it helps to increase the activity of certain immune cells. So those neutrophils, which are phagocytic, those neutrophils will become more active in the presence of a fever than they would have been otherwise. And the other thing that fever does is it increases the rate of production for interferon. Interferon, we're gonna see coming up right next. Interferon is a molecule that infected cells can produce, and it helps to signal their neighbors. Let's take a look at interferon. So this is particularly relevant if we're talking about a pathogen that infects a specific cell. So for example, a lot of viruses are very cell specific. They can only infect certain cells. So it's not just like a generalized, in most cases, it's not a generalized infection throughout the body. Rather, it's oftentimes localized to a particular organ or set of organs. That's because viruses can only bind to specific receptors on cell surfaces. Okay, so if we're dealing with a pathogen like a virus that infects a specific cell, then gene expression in that cell is going to be modified. And there are several different reasons for that. We're just going to summarize it here. We're going to say gene expression is modified. And one of the things that happens is the gene for producing interferon is activated in the cell. This is a cellular gene. It's not a viral gene. Okay, so interferon will be produced by infected cells, and then interferon gets released and acts as a cytokine. So it's a messenger molecule. It goes and signals the neighboring cells to put up their defenses. So it's trying to send a signal to sort of get these cells prepared, so that it's kind of like giving them a heads up. You might experience a viral attack pretty soon. You better get ready. And interferon, in the end, it doesn't prevent those cells from getting infected. That would be nice. It doesn't prevent them from getting infected, but it does help to slow down and inhibit the replication of the virus in those cells. So interferon, this is a subject that is of interest right now pharmaceutically. Interferon has been used pharmaceutically to treat certain conditions, and it's something that I think we're still investigating. It seems like it holds a lot of potential therapeutically. One more example of an innate response, innate immunity. One more example is inflammation. Inflammation is something that can take place, and it has a really amazing sort of sequence of events that occur in order to have it happen. The outcome is that it helps to recruit more immune cells to that region of the body. How does an inflammation happen? Inflammation happens primarily due to the effects of these two different cell types. So we've mentioned basophils and now mast cells. We're going to focus in on mast cells. So mast cells, these are immune cells that are found in most tissues, especially they're present in tissues that are exposed to the external environment. So the skin, the bronchioles, and the respiratory system, and the intestine, the mucous membranes of lining the intestine. These all have mast cells present. And those mast cells, as you can see in the little schematic here, they contain granules. Those granules have two primary things. They have heparin, which is an anticoagulant, and they also have histamine. Histamine happens to be the molecule that is responsible for a lot of allergy symptoms, but we're going to focus in on it in terms of just causing inflammation for right now. So histamine, what histamine does is it promotes relaxation of smooth muscles. So think in terms of your blood vessels. They have a smooth muscle lining, or one of the layers in the blood vessel wall is muscle. And so if histamine is released, then those muscles are going to relax. This will lead to vasodilation, and this will help to recruit more blood cells to that region of the body where the blood vessels are vasodilated. So the other thing that they do in conjunction with that is they produce serotonin, which also helps with vasodilation. And they also produce cytokines that help to increase the permeability of capillaries. So this makes it easier for white blood cells to squeeze through the gaps between the epithelial cells. This also causes fluid to be lost out of those capillary walls. Okay, so things start to leave the capillaries. This can lead to edema locally. So this ends up leading to local swelling a little bit because the fluid buildup in the tissues. But again, this is also helping to recruit more white blood cells into that inflamed area. So this is sort of targeting the immune system to respond right there in that location. So let's say these leukocytes do make it into the inflamed tissue area, okay, due to the action of the mast cells. Once they are there, okay, if they recognize a PAMP, so if the toll-like receptors are activated on those cells, then those cells are going to start releasing cytokines as well. This can further facilitate attraction of other immune cells like neutrophils. Remember, those are one of our phagocytic cell types. And then the other thing that happens is this whole other system is activated, the complement system. We haven't talked about this yet. Basically what it is it's a way to tag pathogens for destruction. It puts a little marker on them, and then the immune system knows to get rid of that item that has been tagged. We'll come back to that later on in the chapter. Once the neutrophils arise, the more neutrophils are attracted to that area, they will undergo, they will carry out this job of phagocytosing the foreign object. So phagocytosis will happen. They will also release enzymes, and they will also release what are called nets. These are extracellular, it's kind of like literally a net. It's a good acronym for it. It's an extracellular net that is made up of fibers, and it just helps to trap the bacteria right there locally, helps to keep them from moving away from that area. So since we've localized the immune response right there, we've recruited more immune cells to that region. If the bacteria are trapped in these nets, it makes it really easy to deal with them. The enzymes that are released, in addition to helping to deal with the bacteria or whatever the pathogen is, the other thing that happens is the tissues right there locally, the tissues will liquefy. This sounds nasty. This is one of the things that ends up leading to the production of pus. So what is pus? Pus is sort of the broken down tissues, the liquefied tissues. So it's a very protein-rich fluid. And it also contains dead white blood cells, dead neutrophils. A lot of our white blood cells die in the process of doing their job. So the collection of all of that stuff is pus, which sounds nasty. But pus is actually very important. The fact that pus is there and it builds up locally, this is something that helps to close off lymph vessels. And so this ultimately helps to prevent the infection from spreading. It helps to keep it localized right there to that region. So inflammation can be a very good thing. It's an extremely useful thing for localizing infections and symptoms that we're probably aware of already. Symptoms of inflammation. What do you think of when you think of inflammation? So tissues that get red and inflamed, feeling warm right there locally. That's another indication of inflammation. But the other thing is pain. Inflamed tissues are painful. So why is that? We know about pain receptors, nociceptors at this point. And what happens during all of this process is some of the cytokines that are released by our immune cells, some of those cytokines work to lower the threshold on our pain receptors. So those pain receptors end up signaling the nervous system more frequently than they would otherwise. Well, not more frequently, but at a lower threshold. It's easier to get them to send a signal. So it feels painful. And what some of our pain relievers do, such as aspirin, other non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, what they do is inhibit the production of some of these cytokines. So that way the threshold is not lowered, the pain threshold is not lowered, rather it's kept at its normal level.